Well, good morning. Good to see everyone here this morning. My name is Jim Mitchell, and I'm on the interim search committee. Have a couple of recognitions I want to make this morning. First of all, our interim search committee has been busy the last 14 months, and we've had an expanded role, but I think we've all embraced it and grown from it. And I want to take this opportunity to thank our chair of our interim search committee, and that is Susan Dillard. So thank you, Susan, for your leadership. She loves being recognized, so that's why I'm doing this. So we thank her for her leadership. You know, it's not often you get to introduce a friend. So I've got two introductions to make, one a personal one and one a professional one. So again, you don't get to introduce a friend often, a childhood friend, someone you've known for 50 years, have been friends with for probably 45 years. There are many stories I could tell you. Fred Lewis still doesn't know why his car was frozen up that one cold weekend in February when he was a youth pastor here. But Tim and I shared many memories. Fab Camp, FAB Singers, Southern Conference tournament games in Asheville, spending $2 bills. Weddings, celebrated each other's wedding. Marshall sporting events. And Tim is still very active in keeping track with Marshall. And also support each other in the times of tragedies and death. As you travel through life, there are probably only a handful of folks and people that you can call close friends. I consider Tim in that handful of friends. So let me share you his professional introduction. That was my personal one. So Dr. Tim Moore was raised and ordained here at Fifth Avenue Baptist Church. He is a writer in residence at Sardis Baptist Church in Charlotte, North Carolina, where he pastored for 20 years. He has served churches in the greater Charlotte area for over 35 years, the last three congregations as interim pastor. Tim is the author of Practicing Midrash, the Reading the Bible's Arguments and an Invitation to Conversation, and the editor of Taking on the Cross, Reimagining the Meaning of Jesus' Life and Death. He is a contributing writer for the Smith and Hellway's devotional guide, Reflections. With a love for the church, Tim has been heavily involved in Baptist denominational work and institutions. Currently, he serves with the board of at Andover Newton Seminary at Yale Divinity School and on the Cooperative Baptist Fellowship of North Carolina's Helping Pastors Thrive Advisory Council, in which he also mentored a cohort of young pastors. In the past, he has served on leadership boards for the Alliance of Baptists, the Baptist House at Duke Divinity School, CBFNC, the Baptist State Convention of North Carolina, and Mars Hill University. Locally in Charlotte, he was a founding member of the Charlotte Clergy Coalition for Justice and served as the co-chair of the Charlotte-Mecklenburg Schools Interfaith Advisory Council. He graduated from Princeton Theological Seminary, from Andover Newton Theological School, and Mars Hill University. Tim and his wife, McGay Shepherd, live in Charlotte and are the proud parents of three young adult children. When he is not writing or serving congregation, he enjoys hiking, playing tennis, basketball, traveling with family, especially national parks, attending Carolina Panthers games, and occasionally making it back to Huntington to watch the Thundering Herd. So it's with great pleasure I introduce you, our next interim pastor, Dr. Tim Moore.
With that introduction, let me welcome you to worship this morning and looking forward to many weeks ahead for the next couple of months, few months, as we have a chance to journey together again after a long absence. It's good for me to be here. I hope this is good for you to be here today. We do want to welcome visitors who are with us and with our congregation this morning. If you will notice in the pews, you should find a visitor's card. We hope you will take that and fill that out with some information. Let us know who you are and place that in the offering plate so that we can be back in touch with you. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Spencer Murphy is here to present an update from the Pastor Search Committee.
It is a bit awkward that I come to you today to talk to you about the Pastoral Search Committee now that we have an interim pastor, but thank you for being here today. As you guys know, since really the middle of last summer, our search committee has been working through the process of finding our next senior pastor. I will report today that search continues. We continue to take on applications, we continue to vet candidates, and complete interviews. We are looking for a unique candidate who understands our core values, our rich traditions, can lead us into our bright future. With that said, I do come to you today to ask for your continual prayers for our search, prayer for our candidates, and prayer for our search committee. A quick prayer for Bev and Brett and Donna and John and Mary Beth and Rachel and Tony and Will, and say one for me too. Actually, say two for me, please. One for the search committee and one because I have teenage daughters. If you guys have any questions, please seek any one of us out. We're happy to talk to you about the process. We'll share what we can. There's a lot that we can't share, but we certainly look forward to continue to serve you guys in this capacity. Thank you very much. Welcome, Tim, again.
Thank you. morning. Please join me in the call to worship. How very good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity. Praise be to God Almighty. It is like the precious oil on the head, running down upon the beard, on the beard of Aaron, running down over the collar of his robes. Praise be to God Almighty. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord ordained his blessing, life forevermore. Praise be to God Almighty. Amen.
Please pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. We ask that you be with us in this sacred place of worship. We come before you with gratitude and admiration. We seek your guidance and blessings as we gather here together. Now please join together as we say the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I'd like to invite the children down at this time, please. Good morning, friends. How is everybody? Good, it's good to see you all. Hello, hello. Hello, good to see you. How is everybody? Everybody doing well today? Excited for a little sunshine? Yeah? Oh, you're not?
Well, I am. All right, so who would believe me if I said I could turn these circles into a square if you didn't see me do it? If I just said, I can turn these circles into a square and then went on with my day? Okay, yeah, do you think you would believe me then because you know what happened,
yes.
Right? Okay, yes. So if you had never seen it in your whole life, would you believe me if I said that? If I didn't show you?
Yes.
No. I don't think you would you? Now, some of you would and some of you wouldn't, but some of you need to see it for yourself to see if it's true, right? Do you want, that's true, depending on who you are. Do you want to see if I can do it?
Yes.
Well, I've practiced, so let's see. We'll see. We've been practicing to see if this will work. All right. Okay. Let's see if these two circles can turn into a square. Ooh, it happened, it happened. Well, you know what? Sometimes people have a hard time trusting in or believing things they hear, like me saying I can turn this into a square, without seeing it for themselves. There's a phrase that people say sometimes that says, I'll believe it when I see it. Sometimes we want proof that something is true. We want to make sure of something before we believe it or understand it. Well, that happened to someone in the Bible. And his name was Thomas. And he was one of the 12 disciples that were close friends with Jesus. After Jesus died and came back to life, he appeared to many people. He came to his disciples one day when they were gathered in a room. And they were overjoyed to see the Lord. How would you feel after Jesus died and came back to life if he came in the room? Show me how you would feel. Oh my goodness, so excited, right? Well, guess what? Thomas was not there. He didn't see it. When the other disciples told him about it, he refused to believe them. He said unless he could put his fingers in the nail marks in the hands of Jesus and see him with his own eyes, he wouldn't believe it. Well, later on, that's just what happened. Jesus came again, and this time Thomas was there. Jesus had him put his hands in the nail marks, and Thomas certainly believed it was him then. He said, my Lord and my God, because he realized the truth of the resurrection. Jesus said, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and still believe. And you know what? That means us. It's hard sometimes to believe something without seeing it or touching, just like Thomas had some doubts, didn't he? We haven't had the opportunity to touch Jesus' hands or see him in person, but we trust in God's word, the Bible. We believe in him and believe the Holy Spirit gives us faith to believe even when we don't see or fully understand. So we are those that Jesus called blessed. We know his words are true and we know he died and rose again, just like we celebrated last week on Easter. And because of that, we can trust that we will spend eternity with him someday. What a wonderful and hopeful promise that is. And it's no trick like these circles into squares, is it? We should thank God every day for that beautiful truth, right? All right, let's pray. Sorry. Dear God, thank you for sending Jesus to live and die for us. We know your words are true and real. Help us to have faith and trust you, even though we can't always see or understand. Amen.
gracious God, as we gather together in worship and fellowship, we come before you with grateful hearts, recognizing that every good gift comes from your hand. As we prepare to give our tithes and offerings, we acknowledge your abundant provisions in our lives. Bless these gifts, Lord, and multiply them for the advancement of your kingdom here on earth. May they be used to support the work of your church, to take care of those in need, and to spread your love to all people. Teach us, Lord, to be faithful stewards of all that you have entrusted to us, knowing that everything we have ultimately belongs to you. May our givings be a reflection of your love and devotion to you, and may it bring glory to your holy name. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
May be seated. Before we enter into a time of prayer, let me mention a few things to you. Please keep Lynn Rogers and her extended family in your prayer in the death of her son, Joseph. Please also keep Tim Hill in your prayer, who had surgery this past week on his shoulder, Hubert Harvey, and as Spencer mentioned, please also keep the Pastor Search Committee in your prayers. Let's go to God together. Creator God, who set the stars in motion and spun this world into existence, we come to you this day, on this Sunday, 24 hours before the moon will eclipse the sun. We may think of our prehistoric ancestors and imagine how frightened they would be to see the sun disappear in the middle of the day. And for us, it's just fifth grade science and a spectacle to enjoy. But may it also help us to reflect for a moment of what it means to exist as your creatures in this expansive universe, to be a part of a world where we are so small that the cosmic forces around us are more powerful than we can hardly imagine. And the changing of the eclipse and the way that we can analyze and use mathematics to understand exactly when this will happen reminds us of the forces that we engage with every day and yet take for granted. So, however we mark the occasion tomorrow, may we take time, may you help us to take time to reflect on what it means to be human in this world you have created, to have this life that you have given us on this planet. And as we watch the amazing solar eclipse happen, may we have a sense of your grandeur and your mystery in our lives and call us again to live them fully and completely as your followers. Oh God, as we think of the pathway that the sun will take tomorrow, circling this earth again, we think of all the situations in the earth that catch the news today. And we pray for people who are living and surviving in Haiti. We pray for all that's going on in Palestine and Israel. Particularly, we pray for the Israeli hostages and for the innocent people children by the thousands living in Gaza trying to survive. We pray for all those who are in the process of trying to bring some sort of peace and protection to the people who are caught in this crossfire. We pray for those in Central America whose lives too often are under the power of drug cartels. For the people fighting for their freedom in Ukraine, and for all those who are resisting Putin's dictatorship in and outside of Russia. So we pray for all these situations around the globe, dear God. We ask that you would help us to also not take for granted the relative safety and the prosperity and the freedom that we have in this land. And may you move us to help us to use these blessings to be a blessing for the world. We're close to home, dear God. We pray for these persons that we have already mentioned. For Lynn Rogers and her family going through the valley of the shadow of death, we pray for this journey of grief that they are in. For Hubert and for Tim, we ask your grace over their medical situations. For the pastor search committee, who this congregation has called to be on the lookout for who you might be calling to be the next pastor of this congregation. We pray for each of them and for their process as they work together as a team and try to listen to one another so that they may speak as one body. And we pray already for potential candidates, that they might listen to your voice, that they might examine their own lives and see if this is a time for them to take on a new journey and exploration. We ask that you would open the hearts of those we need to talk to. All these things, dear God, we lift up to you in prayer. Our lives, this world, nature itself. And we ask that you would renew all of these in this Easter season. In Christ Jesus we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
The scripture passage this morning comes from John's Gospel, the 20th chapter, beginning with verse 19. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And after this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone their sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also called the twin, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in my hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them this time. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus said to him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet have believed." Now Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these were recorded, so that you may believe Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing, you may have life in his name. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. May God bless it for our hearing and understanding. Poor Thomas. He gets a bad rap this time of year. The story of his skepticism is almost always read the Sunday after Easter. Doubting Thomas, we call him. Doubting Thomas didn't believe that Jesus had really been resurrected. He would believe it when he saw it. So sure enough, the very next week, Jesus shows up again meeting his disciples and shows Thomas the scars in his hand. Now, one reason this passage is almost always read the week after Easter is because the text itself, that Jesus returns back to the disciples and Thomas the week following Easter. And when Jesus arrived in their hideout, which was probably the same place where they had had the Last Supper, Jesus goes straight to Thomas and shows him his hands and invites him to put his finger in his wounds. And Thomas believes. Unfortunately for him, believing Thomas never stuck. What I really like about Thomas is that he asked the question that was on his heart. He didn't just bury it. He didn't just go along with the other disciples when deep in his heart he really wondered, did they really see Jesus? Or in what way did they see him? He stuck with his question and kept pursuing it and asking about it. Often we feel uneasy asking questions about God. We feel like we as Christians are supposed to have people who have answers, not questions. And when others around us seem to have so much more certainty about their beliefs, we are less willing to offer up our questions. This is the problem with calling Thomas Doubting Thomas, isn't it? We say Doubting Thomas as if he were less faithful than the rest of the disciples. Of course, they had physically seen Jesus, right? They had had a chance to see him and to touch his wounds, to figure out their own sense of how he was here. Just as Thomas desired, but he was not with them the day of Easter. The fact is, when all the rest of the disciples were like Thomas, when all they had seen were the folded clothes and a missing body and an empty tomb, none of them ran through the streets of Jerusalem saying, "Christ is risen! He is risen indeed!" No, they were locked up in this room, hiding from the Jewish leaders. According to Luke's gospel, when the women disciples who had gone to the tomb, when they returned to their hiding place and told the rest of the disciples that the tomb was empty and they had seen the angels, and the angels said that Jesus was raised, the male disciples said something like, "Silly women." Of course, that would go down in history as one of the faith mistakes of patriarchy. Thomas, you see, was no different than the other disciples. He just didn't have the same experience that they had had. He was the one missing when Jesus first appeared to them. And therefore, he was the one that kept pushing the questions. Why is it that we as the church are so uncomfortable with questions? You might say that a lot of people are uncomfortable with questions these days. Not just the church. The ask of questioning, of entering into inquisitive dialogue, has been going out of favor for some time now. Questions rock the boat. Upset the equilibrium. Why question someone? Why question an idea when it's a lot simpler just to presume you have it all figured out? We are having difficulty as a society talking and discussing things together. News channels target their message to a particular audience. Social media puts us in this algorithm loop where we keep seeing the same things over and over again. We only see the same things that we already believe. Misinformation, disinformation plague the internet. When someone offers an opinion with which we disagree, it is becoming more socially acceptable to shout them down, something that would have been considered rude and bad character a generation ago. College campuses are having big discussions about what freedom of speech means. Universities are criticized on the one hand by students and parents who say they are not protecting them from harmful speech, and then on the other hand, from students and parents who say they are not protecting their right to speech. I feel sorry for college administrators that have to navigate through this climate. Why are we, as a society, so uncomfortable with questions and inquisitive conversations? This mindset that we should only talk with people who think like us, only discuss things in our own little echo chambers, is exceptionally shallow and weak. and in the long term will erode the Christian church's reputation for truth and lead our society to ill-informed decisions and failed innovations. Questions are good for faith, good for ideas, good for society. If the marketplace of ideas is shut down and we only listen to people we agree with, then ignorance will be the only winner in faith, in civil society, in science, and in governance. Perhaps we Christians should ponder what might be the point of believing Thomas's story. John selected specific stories for his gospel and left other stories out. I mean, he said so in the passage we just read, right? Jesus did many other miracles which are not written in this book. These were written so that you may come to believe. So what is it about this story that John thought was so important for us to read and to grapple with? What is it that John thought this story would help future generations of Christians to believe? The conventional meaning of this passage is that it reaffirms readers and hearers of the story who have not seen Jesus and yet have believed. And I suppose people like us, living 2,000 years after Jesus' life and death and resurrection, can take solace in that. We are those who haven't seen and have yet believed. We are blessed according to John's gospel. But you can't get to that affirmation until you follow Thomas's pathway. His refusal to just go along with what the others told him and his insistence that he wanted to see for himself should be an example for all of us to follow. Because Thomas questioned, he got to see Jesus. Isn't this the moral of the story? Because Thomas questioned, he got to see Jesus. When Jesus appeared a week after Easter, he went straight to Thomas, as if that was his purpose for being there. Because Thomas questioned, Jesus came to him. Thomas's story is, in an interesting way, somewhat like the story of Job. Job, the Old Testament Job, who was a rich man, a prosperous man, who loses everything, questions God, yells at God, shakes his fist at God, demands that God answer him. And in the end of the story of Job, Job meets God face to face. God doesn't give Job the answers that he was hoping for, but Job got to meet God face to face. And if I had to choose the two, that's the one I would choose. See, here's the thing. Whether we ask the question that's on our mind about faith at church or in Sunday school or with a trusted friend, whether we ask the question or not, it's there in us. God already knows it's in us. So why not ask it? Why not put it out there? Why not explore it? Why not have a conversation with people who might have some ideas with you or maybe even disagree about it? But the conversation brings all this together, brings the Spirit of God in with this conversation. If it's already in you, you might as well ask it. In an age where truth is fungible and where alternative facts are sometimes suggested to be as worthy as measured facts, it seems imperative for people of faith and people of goodwill to be doubting or believing Thomas's. The book of 1 John instructs us to test the spirits. Do not simply believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. To test the spirits means to question, to discuss, to probe for God's truth. We can't be like Thomas and get to put our fingers in Jesus' hands. So the only thing we can do is to question and to talk and to discuss and to listen with one another. There are so many places in our country and in our world where questioning Christians are needed to probe for truth, particularly areas where controversial subjects shut down debate and discussion and leave the talking to extremists who just shout back at each other. For instance, the education of our children and the advancement of our nation are poorer if we leave the scientific debates only to scientists who, on the one hand, may be weary of religious intervention, and people of faith, on the other, who, for whatever reason, refuse to question their faith in light of scientific discoveries. If we, as the church, cannot bring these folks together in seeking God's truth, then who can do that? Who can bring science and religion together if not the church? This is true with so many other things in life. If people of faith don't stand up and question poverty in our nation and voice the call of God's economic justice for all people, then who's going to do that? If people of faith don't stand up and support the need for good law enforcement and God's justice that all citizens should be equally protected and served, then who's going to do that? Who's got a tent big enough to bring people together? If people of faith don't stand up and question the way we are treating the environment and to voice the call of God's caretaking of this earth, then who can do that? Questioning Christians, the church, are needed to bring all these parts of our society together. You see, we of all people are free to question and to probe all things for God's truth within an open mind because we celebrate that Jesus Christ has been raised and death has been defeated. So we are free, free to question without fear. We question in order that we may believe. So how do we follow Thomas's example? How do we go about faithful questioning? First, I think that we need to work on training ourselves to question for truth, not just for facts. We often confuse the two, but they are not the same. Facts are tools that lead us to truth. They can get us on the pathway to truth, but they in and of themselves are not truth itself. We want to examine evidence for facts in order to get to the truth, but always understanding that the truth is beyond what facts can show us. Biblical scholar Marcus Borg once wrote about a Native American storyteller who would always begin his stories this way. Now, I don't know if everything happened this way, but I know that this story is true. Oftentimes, we modern, scientifically minded Americans, when we read the Bible and talk about the Bible, we spend our time trying to determine the facts of the story instead of focusing on where the story rings true. Thomas wasn't just looking for the facts about Jesus' resurrection. even though he wanted to put his finger in the nail holes. It wasn't just the facts he was seeking. He was seeking to know the truth, the meaning behind Jesus' resurrection. You don't get that just by sticking your finger in a wound. Secondly, faith is not a problem to be solved. It is a mystery to be explored. Problem solvers are always going to solve problems, right? I mean, you got to have problem solvers around, someplace in your family, someplace in your church, someplace in your business, because you need people to solve problems. But they are always going to find an answer, a solution to whatever problem's out there, whether it's the right one or not, because that's who they are. They're problem solvers. They begin with the end in mind. We want to get here. Explorers begin at the beginning. They have no idea what's out there. They have no idea what the end is. They begin with the beginning. They ask curious questions. Where am I? Where am I going? Why is this new thing I'm seeing the way it is? What does this mean for me and others? And every time an explorer receives an answer to a question, it merely opens up a new question beyond that question. Now that I've known this, what about that? And the process of exploration is to continually go from question to question with a deeper and deeper understanding. But every explorer understands that they don't know what they don't know. And they keep searching. And this is okay. It is okay for us to be people to say, I don't know everything. Because we are not saved by our knowledge. We are saved by faith. We are saved by faith, not by orthodoxy or having the right answers or theology. We are saved by faith, and faith and knowledge are two different things. Problem solvers want certainty. Explorers want understanding. And there's a vast difference between the two. Learn to ask curious questions. Thomas saw Jesus the way Lewis and Clark saw the Louisiana Purchase, as an explorer. Third and finally, to follow Thomas's example, we question and follow. Thomas did not just question his friend's statement, but Jesus had been raised. He questioned it and then he hung around. He hung around his friends to make sure if Jesus should appear again, he would be there. He questioned and then he hung around for Jesus to reappear. He questioned and followed. I must say that I learned that here decades ago. I learned that from people like Evelyn Welty, who guided the children's program, from Yvonne Johnson, who at one time was my Sunday school teacher, from Nelson Worsham, who was my youth Sunday school teacher, and Skip and Linda Turner, who would have Wednesday night gatherings with the teenagers. They turned us loose. They gave us permission to question. There was no question that we could not ask. And we were encouraged to follow our questions and see where they led us. Because they believed, rightly I think, that wherever those questions led us, they would always lead us back to God. Cynics question in order to tear things down, to deconstruct. Christians should be questioning to build things up, to shed light on God's truth, to give the world a fuller understanding of this world and how we should live in it. We do not see people with different ideas as our enemies. And in fact, if we did, Jesus tells us to love our enemies, so it doesn't make any difference, right? So we have no need to tear people down who might disagree with us or have doubts about our beliefs. If we are pursuing God's truth, conversations with anyone can open up new avenues for exploration. A skeptical faith questions and keeps following. Questioning is not doubting the faith. It is keeping the faith real and authentic and relevant for the living of these days, which are always changing, which are always confronted with new challenges. As Thomas saw Jesus after he doubted the disciples, as Job met God face to face with his hard questioning, as 1 John commands us to test the spirits, let us practice the art of faithful questioning so that we and others may fully see God's truth in this world and in one another. Friends, Christ the Lord is risen. May we be believing Thomas's, pursuing questions that are deep in our heart until the risen one is revealed to us again and again and again. Amen. Will you pray with me? Oh God, may you trap the thoughts running through our minds and hold them there so that we may reflect upon them, dig deep into them, that you may show us a deeper way to live our faith. In Christ Jesus we pray. Amen. It is in this church's tradition, a Baptist tradition, that we open our doors of fellowship for those who would like to unite with us as a congregation, who might like to profess their faith in Jesus and who wish to be baptized. I'll be by these steps if anyone would like to come forward while we stand together and sing. Well, it's good for me to be back in this place, which is sacred to me and holy to me, as this community helped form me and shape me. So I hope this has been a good day for you and a good way to begin your day and your week as you go about your life scattered as the scattered church. We are the gathered church today. We'll be the scattered church wherever we go this week. Do want to thank some of you who helped us with worship today. Cameron, that was a beautiful prayer. Can I have you write prayers for me, like in the future? That might be pretty good. And John and the choir, that was a great piece y'all sang. Thank you for leading us with that. And Rachel did a good job of getting it started, both Rachels, in worship and prayer, and the children. So I want to thank them for their leadership. I do hope some of y'all have some of these doodads, right, for tomorrow. So do not look up in the sun without something like this, right? We don't need anybody coming back with eye patches next week. Or else, like, get you a box and, you know, do the little pinhole thing, do the fifth grade science experiment and you're on your own if you don't have one of these little things. So the staff, we're going to have extended staff meeting tomorrow, and we'll be ending about the time the eclipse starts. So I've got a few extra of these. So if you want to come by and join us, we can all take turns kind of passing those around. So. I don't have anything else to do, right? Is there anything else? If there's something else to do, Susan, tell me, anything else? All right, good. Okay, let's have the benediction. Friends, as you go back out into the world, rejoice in all things, persevere in prayer, and overcome evil with good. And know that God, the creator of the universe, has already gone before you and is ready to meet you wherever you go. And Jesus the Christ walks beside of you along your journeys. And the Holy Spirit, God's love in all things, is surrounding you and will protect you and guide you through whatever you face this week. Go in peace. Amen.